Welcome to a extra special episode of At the Bar Podcast. We are here in the bright, sunny beer garden in Melbourne, Florida. I am Mike. On the other side of the table, Hollywood himself, Jeff. Jeff, how are you?
Good, always.
Good. We have a trio of guests in this very special, huge episode. I think it's our biggest one yet.
Probably. I imagine so.
So we're going to introduce them all now. To my left, we have Dave.
Hey, I'm Dave Swartz from Coasters Pub and Beer Garden in Melbourne.
Cool. And in the middle, we have Mac.
My name is Mac Monroe. I'm a beer geek, and I've been a beer geek for a long time, as you can tell.
Best kind of geek to be.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm Jason Strobel. I'm in Brevard County. I'm kind of a good craft beer guy. I'm not really in the industry too much anymore, but I've been a pilot brewer for the largest brewery in Florida, brewed a beer with Sierra Nevada, and kind of just love to drink. So
you just you love to drink and make it, right?
That's true.
Awesome.
That's it.
So we cracked open some of Jason's homebrew. Yep. Do you want to take us into what we're drinking here?
Sure, I won't tell you too much about it. I'll let you guys talk about it. So this is a robust porter I make called Chiroptera, and this is a special treatment. It's brown sugar cinnamon coffee Chiroptera.
What is Chiroptera?
It's the order of bats.
Uh-huh.
So nothing really tied to beer, just really cool.
Just a really awesome name.
Yeah. Yeah. It sounds really cool.
The nose on it's extremely robust, roasty.
Wow.
Really robust. Mm-hmm. I would say more than some professionals.
Thank you.
Not mentioning any names.
Somewhere in there, there's a little bit of chili pepper.
That's solid. Yeah. I like that.
Thank you.
You get a little bit of cinnamon.
You get
a lot of coffee, you know?
Yep. So the coffee comes from Indian River Coffee Company, and they roasted it right before I picked it up, ground it, and this is actually cold pressed, and then inject it in the secondary.
Okay.
Sweet. You get a lot of coffee. This is really good.
It's a lot. Brown sugar, cinnamon, and coffee.
Okay.
That's a lot of ingredients.
So many.
Yeah.
But hopefully it plays off itself, you know? It complements everything.
Because the roastiness does play into the coffee almost perfectly, and then you do get a tiny bit of the cinnamon, but it's light-bodied. It's pretty good.
Nice.
Yeah, it comes together. This is really good. I thoroughly enjoy it.
What's the percentage on this?
It's 6%.
Okay.
That's good.
Great.
I like it. So you had something to say?
I was just saying, just easy drinker and got a lot of that coffee.
Yeah, I like
it. It's really easy drinking with a lot of flavor.
Yeah.
A lot of beers like this are 9%, 10%, and you get scared of them after a couple of glasses. But I mean, this is one that's definitely got some.
The idea was actually supposed to make this age this and make this more of a breakfast. Got breakfast stouts as breakfast porter.
It does have that. It has that kind of breakfasty, not that I would
I like the aftertaste.
Beer, but I could.
I like the aftertaste. You kind of get the little cinnamon to it.
Yeah.
It's just cause nice.
It's really so clean.
Yeah.
All right. So Mac is the official beer judge. What do you think?
I'm probably going to finish it.
So it's at least an 8.
I'll take that.
Yeah.
It's a compliment.
So before we get going, Jeff, on a scale from 0 to 10, what would you give this robust porter?
Stylistically, especially for Target going for a breakfast porter, it nailed it. So I'd give it like an 8.8.
I'm in line with that. An 8.8, 8.7 around there.
I mean, it's
a B plus. It's a B plus beer.
For the style. And as far as your ingredients, like you said, you took a little bit kind of a risk with those, and they did play off exactly like you thought they would. So I think it worked out extremely well.
Yeah.
Thank you, guys.
I'm in line with that. Dave, what do you think?
I mean, even sitting here under full Florida sun, I mean, you're not worried about drinking up. You normally wouldn't think porter, but, I mean, it goes well.
Yeah.
It's really not going to make your forehead sweat or anything like that. I mean,
the beer will, the sun will.
No fire in it anywhere. It's just a pleasant sipper.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. It's really good. It's really good. Bravo.
Cheers, guys.
Yeah, thank you.
That's a good point. I actually walked into the bar and was like, what beer do I want? I was like, I really want a stout, but it is sunny outside, so I'm going to go with a Hefeweizen. So this would have been perfect for that exact scenario.
Yeah. So we were here at Coasters Pub and Beer Garden. So I want to introduce Dave again for allowing us to be here.
Well, thanks for coming.
So what are we doing here, Dave? What'd you drag us down all the way from Orlando for?
I tried to get you out of the parking lots of Orlando and get you out here on the coast. We're coming up on our 7th annual Belgian Beer Fest next weekend. And now for 7 years now, we've essentially, it's now the biggest Belgian Beer Fest in the Southeast, at least.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a really good working relationship with a lot of importers and a lot of beer distributors and even brewers over there in Belgium, because we go visit occasionally.
Right.
To bring over them the most rare and obscure and eccentric things that we can.
Mm-hmm.
So all throughout the year, as these special kegs become available, we grab one or two.
Mm-hmm.
Grab one or two.
He made the sign.
As they become available. And we pack rat them away, essentially. And
right.
Which the rest of my staff hates because there's not much free space in the cooler at this point. I have like 48 kegs back there right now for Belgium, and I have another 10.
Totally
coming.
Worth it.
I have another 10 coming. Yeah, there's another 10 or so kegs coming the next couple days. But it's just a big blowout weekend. We do Belgian food specials. We do mussels and Chimay cheeses. So Trappist cheeses.
Oh, my God. I'm excited for that.
I have 50 pounds worth of chocolate truffles that were shipped over from Brussels.
Uh-huh.
And it's a fun weekend, yeah.
So what made you tell us a little bit about how this came to fruition? Are you like a Belgian fan?
Yeah, I am. Me and my wife are kind of, I guess you could call us Europhiles. We're kind of enamored with the culture over there.
Yeah.
But and I like beer a lot. And the culture over there, so it revolves around beer in a pretty big way. It's a country the size of West Virginia, and per capita, there's more brewers there than anyone else. It's pretty amazing. And instead of just over the border in Germany, how they have just a set number of styles they can brew by law, the Belgians essentially have free reign. I mean, they've got the brewing acumen that the Germans have, but they've got sort of like the French artistic influence to be able to be free in brewing and do some really unique things. So I'm a fan.
You're just a fan of Belgians. You just want to have your own Belgian event here at your restaurant.
Exactly. Yeah, I ran across the idea up in Baltimore at Max's on Fifth up there. It's one of the best beer bars in the U.S. Really, if you ever get a chance up there in Fells Point in Baltimore, it's an amazing place. And they've been doing this for I think 9 or 10 years now. And I happened to stumble across it up there in Baltimore one Monday after the events, and looked around. The place was definitely well used this previous weekend.
Right.
And that's what happened here. We noticed that a lot of taps were gone. There was a lot of Belgians up there, and they said, "Oh, it's a Belgian Beer Fest weekend." They told us about it, and it's a really, really neat idea, and decided to bring it to Florida.
Cool.
Yeah, I mean, I know just this event's got to be a huge undertaking just from my side of distribution as well, which I'm sure you battle the same fights. Belgian beers are extremely hard to come by, especially the rare ones. So putting on an event like this must be a huge undertaking. It's pretty incredible that you're doing it with all the rare stuff that you're doing it with.
Yeah, it consumes a lot of time, but it's worth it. It's a lot of fun. You'll see next weekend, I guess, you're coming out.
Yep.
Yep.
So we hope to put on a good show for you. It's a lot of work for our staff. But it's worthwhile.
The really good news is that Belgians store very well because a lot of them are fairly high alcohol.
Yeah.
So, you know, he'll have his first keg for next year coming in within a month after this beer festival,
okay.
I'm sure.
You know, it's got to be a thing you collect over the course of a year because
yeah, sure.
Otherwise this stuff's not all available at any time. It comes as it comes, and you hopefully gobble it up.
Yeah, you could throw a Belgian Beer Fest anytime you wanted to, I suppose, with the beers that the distributors hold
in
inventory. But they're all good beers, but they're not terribly exciting, so it's a good year's worth of preparation and pack ratting to get to.
I think that's what I've noticed with other places doing Belgian themed. They get everything at once as close to the event as possible.
Right.
So everything they have is very kind of standard, and it's not really unique, or it's not going to draw you there. Compared to here, you spend a whole year collecting this stuff and holding on to it. So a lot of stuff you can't get in Orlando.
We have two Belgian coolers, and just to keep the beers on the shelf, and this is majority standard, standard beers that you've heard of, Belgian beers, and even for us to keep the beers on the shelf is a struggle because they come in and out of distribution by the day, so trying to keep Belgian beers on the shelf is already difficult enough because the distribution on them is very hit or miss. So to be able to put on something that, one, has top-notch Belgian beers, but a lot of them, and not your run-of-the-mill everyday stuff, because it would be a struggle just to put on an event that has everyday stuff.
Sure.
Yeah. So putting on something that has really high-end, obscure Belgian beers that people have, this might be the only opportunity they get to try them.
Yeah,
really. It's pretty amazing.
And something pretty cool, too, is there's also a food aspect involved as well. And I know everybody's here for the beer, but it's also cool to have the food, the Belgian beer, be outside in a beer garden. It's beautiful. And it's
beautiful,
a really, really
garden.
Cool event. I've been coming a couple of years now myself, and it's world class. It's a great event, great beers, great time. It really is.
I haven't missed a year yet. So.
I mean, even when we walked in, like the front area, it's like not like a strip mall bar or a restaurant.
Not at all.
You have, you know, the wood decor, you have the signs evenly placed. It's not overwhelming with, oh, we sell Newcastle, we sell Dogfish. It's like very nicely placed. You walk in with like the stone and brick wall, and it's like really cozy and like a sense of like, I felt like I was in like a cave almost, like a cellar, like I was in like a special club walking in, and everything's really nicely placed, and you got the growlers and decorations kind of everywhere. And then you like walk out in a strip mall into this beer garden that you can see, and it's like not expected.
Beer garden that's straight out of Germany.
Yeah.
Like, beautiful.
Yeah. And it's a clear blue day. Like, it's phenomenal. Yeah,
let's cross our fingers for that at the event.
Like you're not in Florida anymore.
Yeah.
With the choice of the plants. And
it's an otherwise wasted space. Everybody looks at an L-shaped strip mall and thinks that somehow or other it's solid around that corner.
Right.
And in every case, there's an empty space out there gathering rubble and things like that. That empty space, that corner that is usually nothing, is now,
you've done an insanely beautiful job with this out here. It's awesome.
Thanks. Pictures don't do it justice at all. At all. So, kind of going to your tap list today, which is, this is before the event.
It's a daily list.
It's a daily list. So this is
nothing. Before I was a beer bar owner, I was a beer bar customer, and nothing annoyed me more than stale, outdated beer lists where you ask for five beers and then none are available.
Oh, that's something we touched on. Going to a brewery, and they have something, or a restaurant, and it's not, they're out.
It's not the best for the environment, but we print them every day too.
Yeah,
you so got to.
It doesn't win us any fans with environmentalists, but yeah, we print menus every day.
You have to have them because otherwise it's.
I mean, you guys do it over at World of Beer.
Yeah, every day. It's the atmosphere aspect. It's the unspoken kind of like thing that slights you when you order a beer that's not on the list, or that's on the list that's not. It drives me nuts. I actually had that happen at Florida Brewing over in Tampa, and three beers I ordered, all three of them not on the list. And I'm like, what am I doing here?
Yeah.
So many times I've been to a beer bar and I go right to bottles because what they have on tap is stuff that I don't really like, or I've had 1,000 times. I want to try something new. I go right to the bottle list, and I've ordered 10 beers, and they're all gone. So I go to the draft list because I don't really want to be there, and they're all gone. So it's a problem.
A beer bar that doesn't have beer.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So I just want
to. What they claim to have, anyway. You know?
I just want to highlight a couple things that we're on. Obviously, this is going to change, but for variety's sake, I think this is pretty exceptional. You have a Doppelbach on draft.
Index Doppelbach, from Bavaria.
You have a quad, a Strafhändler quad, which I don't see those. Hardly anywhere.
A lot of these had backstories too. So I visited both those breweries and pick up.
Straff Hendrick is awesome beer.
Yeah, they're very underrated, I think. You have a Brooklyn insulated Schwartz beer. Don't find those anywhere. And then you have a couple ones like Dolphin 90 Minute, which is good. You have a lot of local stuff, which obviously we appreciate. You have Playa Linda here, Central 28, Monty Python's Holy Grail, which. I got a chuckle out of, but like
you
I like the variety of. I really like the variety of what you have on list, which today. But I assume this kind of pattern goes, you know, every day, seven days a week.
It's a living and breathing thing, the beer list, and now I've gotten to where I've pretty much 2/3 of it are standbys. That at one time we had. A third of the beer selection was standbys over there full time, and then the rest of them I kind of played with. Every once in a while, you rotate through these kegs, and people just love it. And you learn what your customers like, and then you try to keep that around for them. So now we're 2/3 of the list now is full time beers, and the remaining 1/3 are rotators looking for that next great thing.
I mean, I appreciate the we bring in some stuff in.
Ah, we got some Belgian beers over there.
We're bringing them.
In the break, Coasters kind of plays to their. Plays to their own, a beat to their own drum, if you will, whatever tagline is. In our beer world, everybody's trying to get the latest and greatest. They're always trying to get the hoppiest beers they can get on tap. And
God, a trend I hope that dies. The hoppiness, like the I want the hoppiness for the sake of it being hoppy thing needs to go away, because it's just like you're not appreciating stylistically what the beer is supposed to be anymore. An IPA never said that it has to be 144, 150 IBUs.
It's
obscure,
right.
And it's like, I get why that beer sells, because these hop heads out there are thinking we need the hoppiest thing or the newest thing. But at the end of the day, that's a beer that's out of balance and not in style. And I want to drink a beer that's to the style by what it's supposed to be. over any beer that has this obscure high-end flavor that, yeah, I get that people like hops, but does anybody like hops out of balance?
Right.
Right.
There's so many.
I have one minor comment on that same, in the same general area. Coasters, like he says, two-thirds of them are now more or less standards. They wander around a little bit.
Right.
And one-third are things that come through. A week ago, I was in one of Dave's competitors here in town that has about twice the taps that Dave has.
Well, he's sitting right here.
South has their monthly meeting there. So I had to go. Anyway, so I'm looking at like 75 taps. There's a lot of really exciting, interesting, novel beers on this list. Okay?
Yeah.
The thing of it is, most of them are what I call frou-frou. Okay, they're exotic kinds of things that I might want one glass. Okay, and that's it. I'm never going to drink that beer again in my lifetime. I just put an X in that box in my brain and go on. And this we're at a stage in the craft brew movement where we're getting a lot of these different, just to be different kind of things. And their list is not anywhere near where am I?
Right, and that also in that aspect too. When you go to those places that are doing the same thing on the supplier side, where everybody wants to have the newest, biggest thing, it's the same thing on our side in the bar industry, where everybody wants to have the most taps, the most beer on tap. Everybody, and there's a issue with that as well, where now you're competing against yourself. Where I noticed you have a modest tap. As far as numbers, you don't have more. What do you 30?
32. And we have 5 wines.
Right.
Well,
and I think as soon as you get over 50, you're struggling now to sell your own beer. And at that point, I don't know how fresh the beer is when I get
exactly.
it. And I stay away from tap beer when you go to a place like
Yard House
that has 200 beers on tap.
There's no way those beers are fresh.
Yeah, there's not a chance. And it's like, I feel bad because they're getting pressure and they want to be bigger than the guy next to them, right? So they see like, oh, World of Beer has 40 taps. We need to have 200 taps.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, that's cool, but now your beer is not fresh. And then they're getting pressure to go, oh, you need this beer, because it has this many hops and this many IBUs and this. And all of a sudden you have a bunch of subpar beer that's already gone bad on tap.
Yeah.
Yep. And that's what I was talking about, coasters marching to the beat of their own drum, and that I love bars. I will say this, for me, I do like going to places where they have like 75 taps, as long as they're rotating, or, you know, 60 taps, as long as they're rotating and got things. But with coasters, you know, it's very unique. They've got beers that people are forgetting about right now. You know, mm-hmm. a Doppelbach is on tap.
Love it.
Where are you going to find that? Nowhere.
Yeah, exactly.
Come here,
I love
it's
it.
On tap.
Yeah.
It's great.
Yeah.
You know, it's a great style that's forgotten about.
Yeah.
My own favorite beer is regularly on tap here. It's Settled Down. But I think a lot of homebrewers would rank that in the top 10 or 20 beers in the world. That's Bell's Two Hearted, which is
amazing.
You know,
yep.
Yeah. You know, and it's always here. Okay, I can always when I come in, probably not the first beer I'm going to drink. He's going to have something exotic on his beer engine. Okay, and I'm going to try the beer engine first on the naturally fermented beer. I will make one other comment on this place. They only have about 35 taps. Okay. But they've had 35 taps since 1989. Okay, I've been drinking in here since 89 or 90, and at that point in time, I lived in Huntsville, Alabama. I didn't live here. Okay. I was just down on business. But it's consistent. I mean,
yeah.
This is my local. Okay, and it's for a number of reasons.
All right. You want to hear something, Mac? I was maybe one or two when you started drinking here.
I'm sorry?
I was either one or two when you started drinking here. I was born in 88.
Me too. Yeah,
well, here's,
me too. Yeah,
all right. Here's one little curl your
That's
toes.
That's the beer geek right there.
Yeah.
Our local homebrew store guy was at this beer fest yesterday that I poured beer at.
Yeah.
And I told Brock, I need to come and talk to you. I made my first batch of homebrew in the house I'm living in at the moment. I've been in and out of it, but in 1976. Okay. And I'm thinking about recreating it in 2016 on my 40th anniversary as a homebrewer.
Yeah.
So I've been homebrewing longer than you've been alive.
Longer than my parents been married, yeah.
So yeah, to give you sort of a context of beer history with this guy here, you're familiar with Michael Jackson, the beer hunter?
Of course.
He was the first
both
beer.
Of them.
Both
Michael Jacksons.
This guy brought Michael Jackson to Coasters in 1989, I think. No, it was probably later 98. Than that. 98, sorry.
98, I think. Yeah,
so Michael Jackson, the beer hunter, has been drinking beer here with Mac before.
Yeah, that's awesome.
I spent a whole day with Michael, and it was great fun.
You signed autographs?
I did. I have three or four of his of his books that have his autograph.
Awesome.
In them,
but, Max Chest had an autograph for a while as well, but that's kind of faded.
So, Dave, tell us what we're drinking here. I know we opened it a couple minutes ago, and
yeah, so
I've been eager to get into it.
One of my favorite beers, I think. This is the Streus Cheesus, it's called.
Cheesus?
Yeah, this is their 2012 version. This is a Belgian strong dark ale, but what they do differently in here is that they age it on stone fruit for a good 6 months. So you're talking about apricots and plums and dates. They just throw those in the lager tanks, let them hang out together. And you can really, it's not a fruit beer, per se.
No.
But you really pick up on those dark kind of
And your first
raisiny.
Comment would, boy, this has got that nice Belgian fruity character from the yeast. And no, it doesn't.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
This is from the fruit, but it's not an infused beer like a Lineman and Frambois.
It's a strong dark ale?
It's Belgian strong ale, they call it.
Strong ale?
Yeah, it's actually brewed for Christmas time, but it's not really.
Yeah.
It's not heavily spiced. It's got a little bit of spices in there.
Because originally I thought double. When I first tried it, it tasted sweet, kind of that sweeter Belgian double taste. But it's
What I like about this is though that you can taste those heavy fruits come through, the dates and the plums.
Oh, yeah.
That's fantastic.
It is.
And you wouldn't think it's 10%, but it's 10%.
Oh, my God.
I'm surprised.
I can get on the back end. I feel the burn.
It's funny. So that's what the IPAs are chasing right now, the stone fruits, apricots, all that stuff.
Right,
and
they've already been doing it. Yep.
I'm surprised Americans haven't been copying more Belgian creativity lately.
Well, that's
for another topic.
You get a double IPA with apricots and something like that in it. And there's very little hops in this. Belgians have had 504 years to work things out, and the fruit works much better without as many IBUs as you can get of hops in your face.
Yeah, I think that was America looking for an identity in the beer world, and they said, what's being underutilized in Europe and what can we really highlight? And they went with hops, and it worked out because there's a ton of hop heads. But I mean, as far as just historically what the better flavors and beers are, there's not really a lot of hops for a reason. I think they've figured out that you can do a lot more with fruits or with yeast or with malts.
Yeah.
And there's a reason they're not using the hops like that in Europe. And it's because, bitter beer is the same to me as bitter fruit or bitter food. I don't really.
Part of what triggered that hop revolution that drove us to double IPAs and triple IPAs and things like that is the fact that they bought a bunch of European hops to the Pacific Northwest where a lot of the hops are grown, and the hops mutate. Okay, and lo and behold, in a few years we got a whole bunch of much more alpha acidy hops.
Yeah.
In
Washington's Pacific not the same as growing it in Europe.
Cascade, which is pretty much a classic out there.
Yeah.
I think actually is a sport of Holotop. German noble hop, but it got bent in the general direction. And then so some of these new American hops. Some of these new American hops are actually going back to Europe. Okay, you can buy Scottish ales that are hopped with American hop varieties these days, but they don't kill them the way that the guys in California do.
Right.
As I'm starting to see some of the Belgians do the same. America's influencing the world there.
I've seen
some Belgian ales, some triples and stuff that are triple hop.
Yep. I think the Perrier triple hop uses American hops in theirs, and some other ones too.
What's really incredible is seeing some breweries who are taking the time to create their own hops and brew their beer with their own strands, and I think that's amazing. I know it takes like 10 years for that hop to that strand to mature to the point or something. I mean, I heard that. I don't know, but
I'm not sure on that.
But to take the time to put the energy into brewing into making your own hop strand that's only for your beer is pretty insane, and I like it.
Yeah, within 5 years, your alpha acids are developed. As far as a new strain, I'm not sure. But even Florida is starting to do that now. I've recently heard that Florida, one of the universities, is stepping up to increase the amount of Florida hops that we have, the varieties that are coming out of Florida, to hopefully push that out to the market and to the world.
Right.
I think it's going to be.
I'm not optimistic about Florida hops. We have so many, so much humidity, so many moisture-related things that can grow on hops, and so many root borers and stuff like that.
They're
down
very
here.
Susceptible to the fungus.
And in addition to that, our days are too short. You know, the hops like to be further north, where in the summertime they get 18 or 20 hours.
That's why Washington State's pumping them out.
Up a foot and all the way around a wire in one day, you know, and then do it again and again and again.
Kind of getting back to hops and Europe, what I really want to see how this plays out with Stone's new brewery in Berlin.
I didn't know it was actually going through. So it's
yeah,
cool.
Yeah, went through. They're hiring for it now.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So it's going to be interesting to see how the locals.
I mean, the American beer in Europe has been taking off. They love the hop profile. They like what we're doing. So
yeah,
it's been cool.
German is. They're still very local. I mean, they're their own town brews the beer, and that's what they drink because that's what they drink. And there aren't a whole lot of people that in Bavaria anyway that have that are exploring beers outside their city. There's a bigger German selection here than there is in most bars in Bavaria.
That's crazy.
However, in Berlin, you have a much younger crowd, much more that people are going out and experimenting or I don't know whether you call them more artsy or what, but. I think that's the right market to test market, the American-style beers.
I can tell you the worst of the German prejudices. I have a friend of Dave's as well, I'm sure. He's a wealthy, retired steel magnate in Germany, has a yacht in the Baltic, lives up near the Baltic. They have a condo within a mile or so of Coasters. Okay, so
okay.
They're here two or three or four times a winter, and they're you know Tuckerweiss. That's what they really want. They want a Weissen beer, but particularly Tuckerweiss. Okay, and I came in here a couple of years ago, on the opening evening of the Belgian festival, and here's Klaus and Heidi sitting on their bar stools. And they're drinking something that's pale and yellow, and I said, and they're not in it, because the Tucker's gone, you know, all the ice beers are gone for the Belgian festival. And I said, isn't it wonderful? He said, all these wonderful Belgian beers. See, you get a chance to experience all. And he just kind of looked at me and he said, Miller Lite.
Miller Lite. Triple hops.
I talked to him and I said, you know, you gotta understand these people, 500 years of making beer different than German, but it's good beer. No, Belgians don't know how to make beer. Miller Lite, you know.
They're a stubborn bunch.
Yeah.
The Germans, without stereotyping.
You just get to live with it, you know.
So.
This is the big boy. Talk about history. This is Cantillon Gueuze. So this is... One of if not most
this was dropped on us like just now.
Yeah, yeah. So
open fermentation. They had to push back their fermentation schedule this year because it wasn't quite cool enough in Brussels.
Right.
So
as we drink the Cantillon, I kind of want to ask Dave, as you know, we had Ryan from Red Cyphers on a couple episodes ago about you know kind of the process of opening up a brewery and that whole shindig, right? So what's this been like? You've owned Coasters for how long?
About 8 years now.
8 years. So as long as you can remember, what's it been like kind of owning such a unique restaurant and a bar like this one?
Well, it's
a hard question.
It's unique now. Coasters is probably less unique now than it was 8 years ago, 8 or 10 years ago, because
right.
Florida craft beer culture has moved so far in the past decade or so. But this was my regular bar when I was working. I used to be a financial analyst with Harris, and then before that I was an investment advisor. But this is the place I go after work and drink.
Yeah.
And the previous owner, he spent a lot of time in Germany with the Army.
Uh-huh.
And this was the place to find good beer. There wasn't a whole lot of competition there, but I had done some traveling around the world at that point and kind of knew what else could be done, I guess. And not a lot of places were doing that.
David and I... met by sitting on adjacent bar stools.
Yep. Oh, yeah.
When this was a couple years before we bought it, probably. So
yeah.
Three, maybe.
This is phenomenal.
But it's fortunately,
delicious beer. Yeah.
Oh,
unstoppable.
My God. Sorry, go ahead and continue.
But, yeah, so Daryl, the previous owner, the one who started Hub's Pub here, who then transitioned into Coasters, he had worked here 20-some-odd years and had taken 40 days off in that whole period. He worked.
Wow.
He was a workhorse. And essentially,
type A.
Kind of like Jeff over there.
I was
psych.
I try.
And I'm coming back fresh off of travel overseas and seeing cool beer bars in Europe and Australia. Yeah. I still live in Australia, but I was probably really a pain in the ass to him because I was with these suggestions and constant. You know, you could be doing this, do that. Finally, one day, he got fed up with me and threw me his keys and said, "You know, pay me this amount of money, it's yours." So then that was our project there to figure out how to scrounge up.
Yeah, okay.
Now I know what I got to do at my local spot, right?
Yeah, you have to be a belligerent.
Fine, asshole. Jeff, it's yours now.
Be that guy. Yeah. Oh, great, he's coming in here. What am I doing wrong?
But it's been fun. It's cool doing something that you're really interested in. And especially cool being able to have free reign as far as what you want to offer.
Yeah. So. And you guys offer a great product, so you're doing a great
food.
Job.
Yeah, and the same goes with food, too. We try to make as much food as we can from scratch and keep the food menu really really unique. We do exotic burgers. Right now, there's a kangaroo burger on the menu.
I saw that.
We have
I'm getting.
Roasted bone marrow is a special at the moment for appetizer special. So we kind of mix it up and then keep
it. I saw it, and I was like, I should bring it up. I'm like, someone might get really upset. Like, you know, but, kangaroo, what?
So we rotate.
I should bring it up,
burgers.
But I know Jeff's going to eat three of them, so I'm not going to say anything.
So what, you know, what maybe kind of, you know, maybe some struggles more maybe in the last couple of years that you've maybe come across in terms of competition or you know, the beer industry kind of evolving.
What I'm really struggling at is trying to keep up with all the new Florida breweries. I mean, we've been here for a long time, and we're kind of the go-to place. We have the most history of almost any bar in Florida here as far as beer goes.
Right.
And I want to give folks a chance to bring their beer in and see how it is, but every week it's a new Florida brewery coming in, and I can't keep up. I can't offer everybody a spot on the wall.
Yeah.
So that's a tough part.
Yeah. That's a good problem to have, though.
I fear that we're not ramping up to some sort of craft beer bubble. We are
undoubtedly ramping up into some kind of a bubble, but it'll burst and then we'll go on from there. I mean, there'll be a little reset, and then we'll go on up again. I'm a beer geek of long standing, and I'm a little older and a little slower than I used to be, maybe. But I have an analogy in that when I was 8, okay, which you don't even want to think about, all right, I discovered science fiction, okay? And I read every science fiction book I could get my hands on. With two drugstores in the little town I grew up in, and the drugs arrived on Tuesdays and Fridays, and I'd be there on Tuesday, Friday afternoons after school, buy every new paperback I could find, okay? And I knew everything about science fiction.
Mm-hmm.
And I got to the point where I was in my 30s, 40s, somewhere in there.
Uh-huh.
And I found that I could no longer keep up. I mean, just forget it. You know, I can't do that, okay? Done the same thing with California wine. In my 20s and my 30s, I'd visited every winery in California. I knew all about who was doing what to whom.
Mm-hmm.
There's 8,000 new wineries in California. You know, I can't.
Right.
All right. And the same thing is happening to me with beer. I'm a beer geek, but I'm losing the ability to get my arms around all of it. And it's only partly because I'm growing older and slower. The other part is it's exploding.
Yeah.
I'm the same way. And that's why I've kind of pulled back to basics. That's why I have a Doppelbock on tap. That's why I have a Hefeweizen. So
sure. And they're starting a Florida thing where every Florida brewery is trying to have some kind of a wheat with fruit in it thing as a preferably a tropical fruit, you know.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Kind of like a signature Florida beer.
Right, yeah.
And I can't even keep up with those, okay?
Mike just brewed a mango
passion fruit wheat.
All right.
Guilty.
Is that from the Australian craft brewers by any chance?
What's that?
Australian craft brewers by any chance?
No,
one of their recipes? No? Okay.
No. I know, side note, BrewDog really saw their recipes, but that's another... another thing. So
how do you guys keep up with the, to poke questions back at the host, how do you keep up with all the new, it really is where the ramp up here is pretty incredible in the last couple of years as far as new breweries go.
I think I'll go first. To be perfectly honest, Orlando's the worst city in Florida for craft beer, in my opinion.
Really?
There's no real standout in terms of local stuff. So that allows me to kind of experiment in Miami, South Florida, Tampa, Jacksonville, to kind of see what other kind of breweries have. So I'm not overwhelmed with local breweries.
Why do you think Orlando's lagging behind in this?
I mean, I think we've touched on it in the past.
Yeah, I mean,
it's a very transient.
It. Yeah,
very transient. A lot of people just come and go.
It's such a touristy city and a transient city. Nobody's from there or live. Yeah. You know what I mean? So
I've probably met 100 people who lived somewhere where there was snow, and one day they just looked at each other and said, "Pack the car, pack the kids, let's go down to Orlando and find a job."
Yeah, we're going to Disney World.
I'm sure. Absolutely. I agree with that.
They,
yeah,
they come in every day to Orlando, and they a lot of them get, you know, minimum wage or near minimum wage jobs at one of the theme parks or as a server in one of the thousands and thousands of chains around it, but there's no permanency to it. Okay.
Right.
This place, I was living in Huntsville when it opened, but I owned a house 3 miles from here. I'm back in that house. I was back in that house in 91, but I've been drinking in here since 89.
Right.
Okay? And this is my local. All right. And you don't have a lot of that in Orlando. This place, don't get me wrong, this place is transient. Rocket scientists come and rocket scientists go. Okay?
Right.
And space programs and missile programs go up and down. When I was managing a project, I used to tell everybody that worked for me, if you haven't updated your resume in the last 6 months, you don't understand the aerospace industry. Okay.
But, I agree with that. Yeah, absolutely.
But it's a different... It's not like these overnight guys overnight minimum wage guys that you get in Orlando.
Right.
It's a higher class of transients.
Yeah, and I think it's just how Orlando is. It's very touristy. So, unlike Tampa, unlike Miami, you know, Jacksonville, a lot of people in those cities tend to stay there, or you know, move away, come back. To where Orlando, it's a wheel.
It's a revolving door.
Yeah,
which is
you're in for a year or two, 3-4 years, and you're out somewhere else.
I'm a classic Brevard resident. I was born in Michigan. I spent my last 10 years in Michigan in Ann Arbor. I came down here in the '60s to launch missiles and play with missiles. Okay,
pretty sweet job.
I went from here to California, came back here, went from here to Huntsville, Alabama, came back here. And then retired here, okay?
I think that's exactly the reason why Orlando is the way it is.
Kind of a rocket scientist.
Yeah. Yeah. You always came back at some point. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And
you don't get that in Orlando.
The space program is really tied to this area pretty heavily. I mean, so we have rocket scientists in the bar frequently.
Yeah.
Last month, Buzz Aldrin was back here in the beer garden. Man on the Moon, Buzz Aldrin was back here.
And Michael Jackson.
It's hard to impress him, right?
Buzz, yeah.
Oh, this beer garden is beautiful. Not as beautiful as the moon.
Buzz lives up on Merritt Island. So
he lives here. Yeah,
he's a local now.
Teaches at FIT.
Yeah. Yep.
Does he teach at FIT?
Yeah, he's an associate professor.
All right, we're going next episodes. Buzz Aldrin.
Done.
On the moon.
We can make a beer with moon dust. I think we can do that.
Yeah, right.
But yeah, because we were one of the first movers here, and we had got some pretty cool beer industry people on, like Greg Cook from Stone. He was in here before for an event. Larry Bell from Bell's has been here.
Oh yeah.
I'm trying to think of who else. Of course, Joy Redner.
One of my previous lives, while I was a rocket scientist, as a hobby, I was part of a beer distributorship, and we brought Larry Bell into Florida.
Okay. Yeah.
We also brought Dogfish Head and Boulder and a bunch of other stuff. But you know, so yeah, and. I've talked to Larry, okay? Yeah. I've talked to Sam.
Sam's my craft beer hero.
Oh, he's a great guy.
Craft beer hero, Sam Calgione. What do you think, Jeff? Why is Orlando the way it is?
Well, partially because due to the tourism, but partially because the tourism leads to you making your beers for a majority rather than a minority, which means you're making your beers for the tourists who want to drink the Florida wheat beer that tastes like passion fruit. So when you're appealing to the gimmick of tourism, you're going to make your beers that appeal to tourists who are looking for that Florida thing rather than a good beer. So they want a light wheat beer. They want something tropical. So when you're making your beers for tourists, your beer is not going to be made for quality. It's going to be made for the gimmick of we're Florida. Two, I don't think there's a lot of people that are permanent residents of Orlando, which means they haven't had a lot of time to establish a brewery, get a foothold in the community. The community is constantly changing. Your clientele is constantly changing. You don't really know where to target or what to do. So you make mass appeal beers. Okay. And that's kind of why Orlando does that. I mean, Orlando has a lot of breweries, and they have breweries that make a lot of decent wheat beers, some nice lagers, and some Hefeweizens and some things. But nobody's making that stellar, you know, nail it, hit it a home run with an Imperial Stout or double IPA, because we don't have that clientele in Orlando. They're there, but they just don't think they're there. And the brewers haven't been there long enough to target what their audience is and put out beer for the minority rather than appealing to the majority of tourists.
Yeah. I feel like the culture isn't there, too. Sorry, Mac.
No, go ahead.
I feel like the culture isn't there, too. I think that's a big problem. And I think that's part of my hatred of what we're trying to make as a Florida style. You know, we're trying to do the Berliner Weiss, but we're not really doing anything new to it, or we're trying to do in Tampa. They're trying to do the lager, but they're doing absolutely nothing new. They're just calling it a Tampa lager. You know, I think what we really need to do is find something that's unique to Florida. Here, we could have an IPA with some delicious oranges in it or grapefruits, but now that's already done, and we should have done that before, and that could have been us.
You're right.
We missed an opportunity, and if you look at, like, Carolina or something, you know, you go anywhere in Carolina, you see breweries from all over the state. They distribute in the state. But I can't even get Cigar City right here. It's tough. And Orlando, there's only a couple bottle shops that I know of where I can get anything. You know, I'm not going to find Miami in Orlando. At least it's tough for me to find Miami.
Right.
In Miami.
I would disagree with both you guys on the fact that I like the idea of all the breweries in Florida, each finding an individual fruited Berliner Weiss, if you would, you know, a slightly sour wheat beer with a different tropical fruit in it and making it so that you have a central theme that ties all the Florida breweries together that is, and yes, we have a Florida beer and it is a slightly sour beer with some tropical fruit or other in it. And fine, they got to make enough money to stay open.
Right.
Okay. And after they stay open, then they can start making, you know, other things. But that little bit of exoticism appeals to the tourists, and it'll keep a lot of them open, and it maybe consolidate the beer, the small breweries in Florida to the point where then they can go on more and better things. So I don't, I have no objection. I kind of like the idea of a Berliner Weiss with a tropical fruit in it as being a theme beer at every brewery in Florida.
And then we need to name it Florida style.
You don't have
style.
To have them all in right. your lineup. You don't have to have two on your lineup. Just, you know.
But what if we did this? What if we took that Berliner style and instead of making it slightly sour, we made it real acidic and we put fruit in it. So it was unique to Florida, not something that's been done in Berlin
right.
for forever. Let's make it unique to Florida. Let's take what we have, that oranges, those passion fruits, all those great things.
The citrus
make
fruits.
Great. Yeah.
But in Berlin, you know,
now I have to speak on behalf of the dealing with the young and not too beer geeky tourists, okay?
Right.
You make it too sour and they're not going to go near it. You
yep.
got to keep it in a flavor range that they will appreciate, and I have cannot tell you how many people I've handed a really lambic sour beer to, and they said, ugh! You know, and they don't want to come. You got to keep it where you know,
approachable,
where we'll hook the tourists, okay?
Right.
And then once you have that theme running in all the breweries in Florida. Then they can go their own ways with a little bit of financial cushion under them. You know?
I think that's the reason that for us who are in the beer community, we don't view those breweries the same way that they're viewed by tourists, because they are putting out beers that apply to their palate, where
gotcha.
We're looking for something that is a sour Berliner that's unique and different and somebody, you know.
Okay. I will argue that You got to get them financially stable, and the quickest way to get them financially stable is to find something to hook the tourists.
Mm-hmm.
Once the tourists are hooked and they grow a little bit, then they can sit there and they can make their touristy Berliner Weiss with whatever tropical fruit in it, and then they can turn around and make it three times as sour for
all of us,
and everybody will be happy. But you know, I think it's a good common theme for Florida to start with, and it will sell, and we get more tourists in a given year than any other state in the union. So why not lean on them just a little bit?
Yeah.
So what did you think of the Cantillon, Jeff?
I think it's incredible. I was actually like, I was sitting over here, I'm like, we need to talk about this beer.
Oh, it's just
good. Trust me, I was gonna let that go by.
It's incredible. We were saying, I mean, Cantillon, I don't think I've ever had a beer that's not incredible by them. And I don't know their brewing process. Jason said that he knows a little bit more about it, so I'll let him touch that more. But it you know, this is made with love, and they took the time to make sure it tastes exactly right before it goes out. There's nothing, you know, too creatively different about it. It's very simplistic, but that's the beauty of it.
That's the par goose, essentially.
Right. That's the beauty of it, is that it's so simplistic and perfect on every level that it nails everything. And I don't really particularly love sours yet. It's my big thing I'm
That's
working on right now.
That's why I wanted to ask you what you thought.
And this is, I mean, it's not too tart. It's not too acidic. It's not too sour. It's not too salty. It's right in line with everything you want out of a Gueuze. So it's amazing.
It's a simple beer, but it's in no way simple to make. As Jason would be more than happy to explain to you, I'm sure. Because it's multi-step.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so. And it's still spontaneously fermented, right? Yeah. So it's made the correct way, not the way that we try to do sours here.
It's a simple but perfected.
Yeah. Oh, it's absolutely perfect.
But hard to do. Like I said, they had to delay their fermentation this year because it was just too warm in the early fall in Brussels. And they don't have refrigeration on their tank. So
Basically,
open the windows and you see what happens.
Yeah, and basically, if there's a 500-year-old spider web up there, don't touch it. You know,
that's the house spider.
I've heard that.
Yeah, and those are those nests are holding the house yeast. Okay, and when you open the shutters and let the breeze blow through, and the yeast falls into those shallow pans, where this stuff is fermenting, it's essentially spontaneous fermentation. It is controlled over 500 years spontaneous fermentation. They've been
it's
yeast
incredible.
The yeast and the beer have been working against each other or with each other for hundreds of years, and it's a stable system. You don't want to mess with it.
Absolutely
it's
not.
Phenomenal.
They nailed it.
Yeah,
I
phenomenal.
I would say it was Jolly Pumpkin, and don't quote me on this one because my memory is horrendous, but I think it was Jolly
Just
Pumpkin.
Just make it up.
Yeah, but you make it up as I go.
It's okay.
We'll correct it in the comments, right?
Someone
that's what
will.
I heard.
Yeah.
So they moved brewer houses, and their product was not the same as it was, and in their old brewer house, they had like this terribly, like, I'll say moldy, disgusting roof. And what they ended up figuring out is, I guess, some of that was getting into their beer, making it the way it was. So they actually took the roof off and moved it to their brand new brew house, and they hung it over top of the fermentation tanks.
Wow.
Jolly Pumpkin did that?
I think it was Jolly Pumpkin. No. Don't quote me on that.
Jolly Pumpkin.
Some brewery did that.
Okay. I was part of the beer distribution organization that brought Jolly Pumpkin to Florida. And I've been in their old brewery in Milan, Michigan, right outside Ann Arbor. I've never been in their new brewery, and I don't know that.
In Warren, right there in Warren.
I can't vouch for that.
Jason's on his own.
Here's my laptop.
He's on his own on that one. Yeah.
It's a great story, and I wouldn't dispute it either. Okay.
So on that note, Dave.
Well, we're next batch here, and next tasting. This is from Bruges, and Bruges is an awesome city. If you ever make it to Europe, you've got to go to Bruges, one of the few cities that was not touched by the wars. So it's essentially a medieval city. It still has a moat around it. You still have to drive over the moat to get into the old city center.
Say what?
And in the old city center, there's a building dates back to 1542. That was, and they're brewing beer in it for the last however many hundred years.
And you know all this by going to Europe.
I was there five months ago, in October.
This has one of the coolest noses on a beer that I can't even pick out what style. Like, stylistically, this is completely obscure to me. I have no idea.
It's a barley wine.
It's Belgian. It's not obscure at all.
Yeah, they can do anything. But the nose is awesome. It's delicious. Yeah.
It's not. It doesn't even smell like a Belgian beer at all.
No, it's definitely not.
A little bit floral.
Yeah.
Slightly,
So this is now our standard house quad instead of St. Bernard's Ave 12, which is a fantastic beer, but it's pretty readily available.
Props to you for doing that.
This is a little more hard to find. We know the folks that send it over to the U.S. now, and we're kind of one of their approved bars. So now they're sending us over some super crazy stuff for us for Belgian Beer Fest. Some aged, some multi-year aged, barrel-aged beers that should be available next weekend.
And beyond.
The talent here at this brewery is amazing. And just walking through these 400-year-old buildings where they're still brewing beer today is pretty amazing.
What brewery is this?
This is a half-man brewery, which means Half Moon in Bruges.
Awesome.
The taste I got was so malty, I didn't expect it compared to
a
little bit bitey of a nose.
11.5%. You never see that coming.
No, I just took a big sip, and it did not taste like 11.5% at all.
So they've outgrown their riches a bit to where they're able to export beer. They're able to make and export a lot of beer now relative to how they used to be. But Bruges itself is such a historic city that the town council wants their trucks out of town before 10 a.m. so the tourists can arrive.
Right.
So what they've done is they've gotten with the city, and now they're working on a beer pipeline that's going to literally be a beer pipeline that runs along the incoming water supply that ships their beer out of the city limits, outside the moats, to where they can package this just outside city limits.
Wow.
So they take beer pretty seriously in Belgium.
Yeah, you're not kidding.
So my question is, you might have covered it, how do you establish such a relationship to get these, kinds of beers?
Pretty tenacious, I guess.
Travel a lot.
Like the travel.
Travel and meeting the right people.
You know what? As pestering helps a lot. You really should pester people.
That's my new move now.
Yeah.
Now I know.
Now we know.
Be that thorn.
Many years ago when I was poking around California, I actually lived in California for 4 years, and I was working for people here in Santa Barbara County, Vandenberg Air Force Base, and they'd go home at 4 in the afternoon on Friday, so it's 1 o'clock in the afternoon on Friday, and I would leave and head north towards the Napa Valley and poke around. And I learned very early on that, you know, they'll test you. Okay, I went in a winery on a Saturday morning, and I spoke to the fellow who was there, and I asked him about a tour of the winery, and he says, "Well, we schedule tours on the half hour only, and you just, you know, it's 3/4 of the hour, so you got 45 minutes. Just come back in 45 minutes, and we should be able to do a tour for you. Mm-hmm. That's a test. If you don't come back in 45 minutes, you come back some other time, you know, you're going to get the same routine again." I came back in 45 minutes. I ended up really good friends with the guy. I still correspond with him. He's gone through 3 jobs and things like that. But, you know, but they'll test you, and they do the same thing at the breweries. You got to be serious, or you got to have a hook.
Yeah.
Okay. I had a whole day at Weinsteffen one time because a friend of my wife's had given the brewmeister, the head of the brewmeister school, permission to put his name on one of her poems. So he owed her big time, and she collected the favor by, you know, giving us a free day at Weinsteffen with a full-time guide and in and
the
out of the beer.
Brewery in the world.
Yeah.
In and out of the beer stube and around and look at this and look at that. You know, great, you know. So you either got to have a hook or you got to be a little persistent. Okay, but both.
That's not hard to do either, you know, being, you know, that thorn, more or less.
Good news was my wife lived 10 years in Germany and was fluent, okay? So
I'm sure. So this beer is really good.
Very good.
Yeah, it's
very
impressive, yeah.
It's a lot more malty than
a light-bodied quad that's really nice. Easy drinking.
Right. Yeah. I really thought we were going to get some hot bite to it with the aroma. I get a little bit of bitterness in the aroma, and I thought, man, I'm going to get
all these beers have been phenomenal.
Yeah, it's like super smooth. You really get that candy sugar flavor that I want out of a quad. It's really good, but I don't get that alcohol heat. I don't get that.
It's pretty impressive at 11.5%. They hide it that well.
It tastes like 7 or 8%.
The nose just smells so great that it almost tricks your body into thinking it's not 11.5.
Really.
Yeah,
I was gonna say. Yeah, that's why I was like, I don't know what style we're looking at here.
And you get that nice full body. It's real delicious, real smooth, and not hot. Yeah, it's good.
So you need to bring your camera back on Friday or Saturday and run the draft line.
I mean, these beers have all been phenomenal, and I know I talked to Jeff. You know, I'm not an expert in Belgian beers. Kind of stayed away because one, they're more higher priced than normal.
Sure, they are.
And then two, they're very, not plain, but like kind of get the same thing more or less. You get the yeast, you're like, no, okay, this is good, whatever. Compared to other styles where you get more complexity and stuff like that. And looking at your menu real fast, your beers aren't that expensive for what you're getting.
Kind of.
Like, I wanted to point that out specifically because it kind of blew my mind.
Yeah, we like to deliver a good product at a reasonable price. And I don't want to rip anybody off any more than I like to be ripped off when I'm a customer. So it's fair pricing is pretty much what we go by.
For example.
That's the cornerstone of what you're doing. Yeah. You got to take care of your customers, they'll take care of you.
And you know what? If some of these beers were $2 more per sample, people wouldn't try them.
Correct me if I'm wrong, Dave. You're at Doppelbach.
I don't know how to say that. Yeah, index. Doppelbach.
Is $5.70?
Yeah, I should be charging $7 for that probably.
Yeah, $5.70 for that. I paid.
He's taking a pen right now.
Yeah, you're right. I should be charging more.
So Andex is it's a monastery about 45 minutes southwest of Munich, and their beer is pretty amazing. It's been rated the best Doppelbach in the world for quite a few years.
I paid $6 for a Keybilly last night, for reference.
I paid $15.
Keybilly is fantastic. I love it, but. In comparison,
yeah,
$15 for a 6-pack of Sculpin IPA, which is insanity. But that's the price it is off the shelf.
Yeah.
So in comparison, you have a double lock 8% versus a 6.5.
And those are bar prices too.
And import, which I hate that word, but an import beer that is high end and high ABV, and it's that probably that's I mean it's incredible.
That's an amazing place. If you ever make it to Germany, you have to go by Andex. It's on a hill. It's an old monastery that there's, the monks are still brewing beer. We went there actually this past October again, and stopped by for lunch, having a nice half liter of the Doppelbach. Right. And next to you, the actual monk's robe. Here he comes. He's sitting down having lunch.
That's awesome.
That's so cool. So,
I had some buddies go to West Vletteren, and I have friends from Belgium. They grew up in Belgium and stuff, so they came over here. But the pictures that they have when they go get the beer and bring it to us, yeah. You'll see a monk, and he's like complete garb in his monastery, and he's like on an iPad, and you're like, this is so wrong.
Is it West Vletteren or West Vletteren?
West Vletteren, as far as I know.
If you go there and you ask,
Saint Sixtus.
It's West Vletteren.
Interesting.
But you know, we had a goose earlier, right?
Yeah.
Can you say goose in Flemish? It's kind of like clearing your throat.
Isn't it geis?
You know.
So it's goza. Yeah.
Well, no, it's
well, two different. No, it's geis.
Goza is a different style of beer.
German.
German. But the Flemish for goose is like,
right.
It's like clearing your throat.
Right.
And so never argue with the way the locals, just get close enough that they'll bring you one.
I want that.
I'll say my Flemish friend from Belgium calls it Saint Sixtus. So she'll just call it Sixtus, and that's what she references for the monastery and the 12, which is their West Vletteren 12, Belgian strong.
West Vletteren.
West Vletteren if you go there, though.
I just say Westy because everyone knows what I'm talking about.
Nailed it.
So going on with this prices, Lindemann's Frambois, $5 a flute. That's fantastic.
Yeah.
If you want to drink Frambois.
Yeah. Well.
These crows are crazy.
That's a boat-tailed grackle. I call them parking lot birds because they hang out. In, you know, you see them around all the Walmarts and things like that.
They're
flying raccoons. He's right. They'll pick up any kind of garbage or scraps. They're as good as seagulls.
They're down for whatever.
Good for them, man. They're helping the community.
Yeah. One more price I want to point out. Your Central 28, which is Orlando-ish. They're a little north. There's Miss Mary Brown Ale, $5.25.
Should that's, I be charging more for that?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I mean, that's prices. Essentially brewery prices there.
Maybe on the north side of Orlando. Not necessarily.
It's a little north. It's there.
Charge the higher price over there,
the
not over here.
The difference here is that we're also, we sell more food than we sell beer. No, we're a restaurant before we're a brew pub. And we have a much larger.
You have the luxury of selling at a reduced price.
Yeah, you're
which
in.
Is still great if you're coming here to drink, you know. Good, yeah. 32 taps and you're paying brewery prices?
I guarantee that's a huge reason that the regulars you have are coming. And that's what you mean. You found what works for you, and that's awesome.
Yeah,
because I mean, we appreciate it. And I'm sure you have a handful of regulars who appreciate that. So
absolutely. This guy's been coming for
that's awesome. Because take care of them, they're going to take care of you for a long time.
Right. I've never seen Frambois for $5 ever.
This is a small town, too. I mean, we're not overrun with tourists like you were in Orlando. And
right.
You run into the same people at the bar as you do, you know, taking your kids to soccer practice or whatever.
Right.
So it's a small town. It's a different atmosphere, I think.
We're completely off the beaten path, but we get great beer. So it's like the perfect combination to have cheap beer and a great product.
I mean, your pricing is...
It's
my
fair.
Gosh.
It's fair.
Oh, yeah, it's beyond fair.
Well, see, if you're a beer geek, you know, I live a little over 3 miles from here, just on the other side of the Indian River.
The bridge.
Okay, on the bank of the river. Yeah. And 4 blocks from my house, there's a brew pub, Intracoastal Brewing. Okay? So I can walk 4 blocks one way, or I can drive 3 miles or hike 3 miles the other way and be in Coasters. I mean, if you're a beer geek, you know, it's like paradise.
Yeah, it really is. I mean, that's why I was really surprised with the pricing. You know, Belgian beers, you're paying $8, $9 for a snifter to where you could get a flute of Frambois for $5 here. Like, unheard of. So
it's just, I don't want to rip people off, and it's...
I think that's...
Hopefully
they'll
come back as a return customer.
I think a good trick is being on the other side of the bar and... knowing what it's like to pay a premium, and once you make that switch from in front to behind it, you kind of appreciate, you know, the other half of the, you know,
for sure.
Life.
And yeah, I was I was a regular at this bar, so the customers knew me.
Yeah.
And then I also.
Wait, you're the owner now?
Right. Yeah. Exactly.
So. So I gotta give you
to double prices.
I gotta give you a lot of props on the pricing because I know we ding pricing a little bit. You know, it's not worth. You know,
well, you also have, like, you're in the tourism bubble over there in Orlando where prices as a tourist, it's like you're on the Price
would
is
be
Right.
More inflated. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. It's like Price is Right pricing where a TV is $10,000.
I mean, there's a brewery that I know Jeff is a sarcastically a huge fan of. Their pricing for their pints was in line with Green Flash.
Wow. Okay. That's
Were the pints in line with Green Flash?
That's not the one that I'm sarcastically.
I'm sarcastically mentioning it's your favorite brewery.
No, you have them confused. You're talking about Persimmon Hollow, and you're.
No,
and my story is
Persimmon
about
Hollow is factual. The other one is sarcastically your favorite brewery because you have such a burning hatred.
Because they're my least favorite brewery?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But their pints of beer was in line with Green Flash. They're in Sanford.
They went into distribution.
Wow. Amber Ale.
They went into distribution yeah. with a bunch of beers that they had upgraded all their brewing equipment to meet distribution. Thanks. They didn't fine-tune or change their recipes in any way. They didn't test their packaging. They did nothing. They just said, oh, here's our recipe. We're going to brew it on a larger scale. They put it out. Everything came out metallic and watered down.
Oh, wow.
Everything. So we had a launch event for them. And we were there, you know, hey, you're a local guy. We'll do a launch for you. And they tell us the price of their kegs, and they were line priced with Green Flash Brewing. And they're a local brewer that is non-established. Nobody has heard of them. And they're pricing their slims at the same price as Green Flash. And we still did the event because we're like, you know, we're still going to support local. We want to have you guys come out. And when they came out and their beers all tasted the same, watered down, metallic.
Wow.
Just they never fine-tuned the new brewery equipment. I had heard rumors through their distributor that they had issues with the cleaning properly. All their lines were gunked up. And I'm like, this is a brewery that's trying to charge the same as Green Flash, which granted, like, I don't think Green Flash is like some stellar brewery, but like their beers are consistent in quality.
And they're coming from the other side of the country, not...
Yeah. Not
10 miles away.
And yeah. a lot of hops, too. I mean, you got to consider that, too. Hops are really expensive.
All kinds of places they can right. stop on the way across the country.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, yeah, and that's
exactly.
Here, that's know? Actually a great point because.
Yeah. We all right. Under the previous owner right. to Coasters, I had a chat with him one day. I happen to like a couple of Anchor's beers, and I was really hoping to see some old Foghorn on draft. And he did it once or twice, but basically, this is 20th century, not 21st century argument. Okay,
right.
But basically, he says, you know, look at it from Anchor's point of view. If I'm going to put a keg of any of Anchor's beers on draft, Anchor commits 3 kegs. There's one going back, there's one coming, and there's one on draft. Okay. And that's a, you know, they don't have to commit 3 kegs to any one of 25 nearby pubs in San Francisco
right.
that
right.
will put it on, and they worry about the shipping and worry about getting them back. You know, how many people do you know that have a old beer keg that they found somewhere in their backyard?
Right.
Those beer kegs cost somebody every time.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know? I mean.
But just the commitment to have 3 kegs.
In transit.
The loop for Coasters to have one on draft.
Plus a little tap right. handle.
Yep. Yeah. You'd be amazed at how much money you can lose with people making off with your tap handles.
Oh, and I mean, another thing.
Knows.
You guys used to drive me.
Well, we don't have them anymore. Now, okay. Now it's a company mandate that we are not allowed to have beers without the proper brewery tap handle. I'm going to refuse beer that I ordered because they don't. No, I'm going to make a tap handle for it.
No, well, but Wob used to have every beer that ever been poured that they kept.
Oh my God, some of them still do, and it drives me nuts. Those are the ones that are screwing us over.
And if you're somebody like I was when I was in the beer manufacturing business, and we were struggling, okay, that tap handle staying there hurt.
Oh, of course.
Okay. Now you can have it as long as you want, as long as you keep bringing the beer in.
That's taking your $20 bill and stapling it to the wall.
One of the problems was that there it was a big thing to rotate and rotate and rotate. So you'd come back, but in the meantime, that you wasted a year of that tap handle. You know?
Absolutely, I agree with you completely. And the other thing that Jason just brought up was a good point with Green Flash is that they brew a lot with hops, and that's another reason their price is high, because hops are expensive. But also, it's a huge commitment for a California brewery that does a lot of hops to sell in Florida too, because they're committing to sell a beer that might not taste the same way they intend it to.
True.
By the time it makes it to Florida, hops fall off very quickly. By the time that beer gets tapped, there's no guarantee that that's the freshest that they wanted it to be. So, of course, it's going to be expensive for you to sell that beer here. And then you have a guy 10 miles down the road selling for the same price, and it's like, you have none of the same issues that this other brewery has, and you're trying to sell at the same price as them. It's like, what do you, what's the problem? Right. What are you doing?
And I made a joke about it earlier, probably nobody got, but I was like, and they probably sent you an amber ale, you know? It's like, you get an amber ale, and it's like, next to like a triple IPA, and it's the same price, and you're like, wait a minute here, that's not
right. No, right. Yeah. I mean, Green Flash West Coast, I think you have West Coast on right now.
Yeah.
Incredible IPA. Honestly, like, as far as West Coast style, very hoppy, hugely upfront hoppy, but very balanced in the finish. And it is a complex IPA that I enjoy. And I don't like a lot of IPAs because I don't think they're imbalanced. That one nails it. That beer deserves to be more expensive than the Joe Schmo's Milk Stout, you know? Like, and that's the problem, is a lot of these guys get too big for their britches right out the gate, and they think they're hot shit. They're a big fish in a small market.
So
what are we drinking now, Dave?
So getting back to the basics, the Belgian Triple, these folks invented it.
Westmalle,
which is one of the few Trappist brewers.
They definitely also have the first double. If you ever had a double, these guys did the first one.
Really? Jeff has a healthy heaping over there.
I have a huge
good thing
glass.
You're a co-pilot.
Sorry about that.
It's good for me. Yeah, I'm riding shotgun on the way.
Yeah. Chug.
The nose is light on this.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
It's a really classic triple, and it's right on.
This is kind of the par. It's just a benchmark that all triples kind of base themselves on. Just like
a lot. It's a big flavor.
Yeah.
Big punch in the mouth.
And again, the alcohol is hidden.
Oh, it's there.
Well, that's in Le Fin du Monde is a triple, I believe, right? Unibrew.
Yeah.
I think so.
I think Le Fin. The flavor is similar, but I think the booziness comes through more. I like that this hides the booziness a little bit more.
Yeah, it does.
For a very similar, I mean, look, Unibrew does great beers, but this is obviously, it's Trappist. It's probably been around a hell of a lot longer. And
these are the inventors of the style.
Right.
Much.
So this, like I said earlier when we were off camera, unfortunately, but I think that Belgian beers do a great job of hiding ABV. And this one does an amazing job of it because there's none of that booziness for a triple.
It takes a lot of skill to do that. Yeah,
it does. Something unique I love about triples too is, I think they're very, I'll say crisp, I won't say hoppy, but you get that crispness with the sweetness.
Like palate cleansing almost.
It is, and it's a very balanced beer, but it's that crispness that's great.
Yeah, the crisp finish, almost lagery, even though it's not a lager. I don't want to bash it by saying, but you know what I mean? Very crisp.
Mm-hmm. If you can use a 10 or 11% alcohol beer as a palate cleanser.
Right? You know? Great job.
Only in Belgium, right?
Only in Belgium, or in Coasters, or in, you know.
That's where,
You have to be really careful about doing that if you're expecting to go home that night, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Well, that's where I got to disagree, unfortunately, with my co-host, where I think that I'm not particularly huge on Belgian beers myself, but I do think they're insanely complex.
Always.
I think German beers, which is where he'll probably come back and be like, German beers are so complex. I think German beers are not so complex.
I would agree with you.
And I think Belgian beers, there's so much you can do with them that from every aspect, carbonation, mouthfeel, nose, everything, there's just a million different ways that every style can taste. And I'm not a usually yeast-forward guy, so they're not my favorite styles, but I do appreciate how complex, like I said, this tastes like Le Fin, but hides the booze completely and has a crisp finish. And it's like, how many different styles of beer can have that many different taste notes that are, you know, obscure and different just for that style?
It's okay, Jeff.
We're allowed to disagree occasionally.
I mean, I like Belgians. They're simple but complex.
I'm not getting in the middle of that.
Good thing we're on the other side of the table.
I think there's a whole style of German beers that are very complex. You know, the box, the double box. You know, that whole realm that America has forgotten
about. They have to do everything in that mouthfeel, everything you get in your taste buds with four ingredients. And you have to really work those four ingredients hard sometimes, like with triple decoctions with some of their beers to bring out some of those.
Yeah. I spent
flavors.
A little bit of time in Munich. I spent like a week in Munich. And when I say a little bit of time, that makes it sound longer than it actually was. I spent a week in Munich. And the beers were all very similar everywhere you went. Everybody had the same thing on tap, and they all had
like a strong lager, a lager, and like a Doppelbach, and like kind of, and it was just like regular, and then honestly, like some just light pilsners and things. Like that was all it. And it's like, I always went, because at the time when I went, I wasn't into craft beer. So I was all, I'll admit it, I was the ABV whore.
But that's
I'm the Miller Lite guy.
Germany's like, very, very territorial. I mean, they'll right. have their little batch of beer here. The next town over is going to have different set of the same sort of beers, but
right.
different ones.
So well, I thought to myself,
won't find
I'm
a
like,
place with 30 beers, different yeah, beers on tap.
I could drink. I could drink four beers on tap at each bar I went to, and I tried everything that they have to offer. And it's like, I get that there is complexities to German styles, but there's less popular German styles that are great. And then there's like the four main styles that they focus on that all taste eerily similar to each other. The ABV fluctuates, the mouthfeel fluctuates a little bit, but they all taste a little bit the same.
Yep.
And those are the ones that they, you know, throw at you. They throw at you nonstop.
Nailed it.
If you have a month sometime. Okay.
It's going to take a month. You're right,
Mike. Yeah. Start up by the Baltic.
Because that's your Berliner Weiss is up there.
And not only the Berliner Weiss, but there's a trend in the British Isles and in Germany, the same trend that the beers are drier and hoppier at the north end and maltier and maybe a little more complex.
I just spent a lot of time in the south end, then.
So think of Kolsch's, though.
But if you just drive down the highway and you stop in every little town, 5-10 clicks apart, okay, there'll be a brewery, and you'll find the Gasthaus for that brewery. Okay, and they'll show you their beers, they'll feed you your beer, their beers, and they'll tell you, now this is the way beer is made. Those guys 5 clicks north,
they don't know. They don't know how to make beer.
5 clicks south, they don't. But if you do that and you just work your way down, your beers will be about 50% more malty by the time you get to Munich than they are when you're on the Baltic coast. You know, and.
Yeah,
but it's every single stop. Nah, those other people, east, west, north, south, they don't know how to make beer. Only perfect beer is made only here. You know?
I kind of got that vibe when I was there too.
Yeah, that's the way it works.
If you're ever in Philly, there's a place called the Hofbräu House, and I only bring this up on a Florida podcast for one reason.
Because there's one in Tampa, right?
Huh?
There's one in Tampa, right?
There may be. I don't know. I don't know
there
if
is.
There's.
Yeah.
Hofbräu House.
I don't know if it's Hofbräu a chain
House.
Or if it's,
no, it's
separate.
One.
But so the one in Philly, they've got like 70 beers on tap, which is a lot, but it's all German, but they go through all the different styles.
Good.
And there's, you could sit in one place and you can get a bunch of different beer, and they have a lot of beers that only go to the Hofbräu House. They're nowhere else in America except for the place in Philly. And they'll tell you that a lot as you're walking the door. But there's a lot of variation there that you would never guess because, like America, we're getting, you know, in America, you go to a place and it's like, oh, pale ale, IPA.
Right.
Everybody's got like the same thing. You're like, well, this pale ale kind of tastes like this IPA, which kind, you know, or the pilsners, as we were talking about, kind of off mic.
Oh, yeah.
You know, everybody's got like four pilsners on, and you're like, is this really that different?
And you know, and the thing is, like, a truly German style that I think is underrated because pilsners have eclipsed it is a Kolsch, and I think Kolsches are incredible because they're almost a hybrid of lager and ale. They have great flavor. They're brewed at an ale temperature, but they're a lager style. And it's just, they have a body that's not seen in a lot of lagers that still has that same kind of light flavor. And I think Kolsches should make a huge comeback. However, everybody's pushing these German pilsners all day. And it's like, if you took the time to think which style would sell better, it just based on flavor and complexity, you'd be pushing Kolsches all day, but you don't. Mm-hmm. You know?
Or even Munich Dunkels. I mean,
if you go to Cologne, where Kolsch comes
yeah.
from, okay? You know, they're each place sells only one variety. There's seven or eight varieties, but you have to go to different places. Okay? But it's like a 300 milliliter. I mean, it's less about 200 milliliter probably. It's a small glass, okay? But they'll bring you a lot of them.
But they just keep bringing them.
Yeah, and marking on your beer deckle, every one, so that when the time comes to pay, they just look at how many marks they've made around the beer coaster, and that's what you pay for.
That's know? Awesome. That's really cool.
So I've thoroughly enjoyed, I mean, dude, this list is crazy, but Belgians is, I think, growing on me after today. You know, I've finally been able to dive into Belgians and
finally beginning to get a feel for them.
Get a feel for it, yeah. I've always been intimidated by Belgians.
This
so.
Could be ruin your night, really. This is a
my night's never ruined when I drink.
This is a 1996 beer from Belgium.
Wow.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
So glad I showed up today.
And it is corked. Corked finish. So,
yep. So we got some crazy old Mac. We opened up a 1960 some odd bottle for a Valentine Burton Ale one night.
Yeah. I've been told that PBR is, they're doing some historical style beers occasionally.
PBR?
Yeah. Okay.
And they still put them in bags, though.
And
they're talking about trying to bring back the this Burton Ale that hadn't been made in the United States since the 60s or there.
64, I think.
Yeah. And they rummaged around on the internet and they found a video where there were two people talking about and drinking this beer, and it's Dave and I. So they want to talk to us, but nothing ever came back. So I think they probably dropped the idea.
Yeah, we had me and Jeff 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago. We did a blind taste testing of a 10-year-old Budweiser.
Carbonation in there still.
Interesting.
It's a private reserve, so it's like Budweiser brews the first runoffs of whatever beer, and they give it to employees only. It was a 2006 batch of Budweiser Private Reserve. That's what they called it.
I remember that release. Yeah. But Budweiser and Bud Light, when they do it, they essentially they stretch that batch of beer out as far as they can. This is the first runoffs of one of the batches.
Yeah.
I think
it was really good.
Really.
Really good. Yeah.
Funny. Well, it's funny that they're throwing away their first runnings, which as a brewer, I'm like, that's like the cream of the crop, you know?
Yeah. They give it to employees.
They take it away. Yeah. Well.
That makes you question, like, why would they do that? And not bottle it and sell it, like
Beechwood aged.
Yeah, the hard way.
The hard way.
Yeah, we're the hard way.
But it was 10 years old. There was some sediment in it, but it. Jeff said it smelled like a barley wine, which I give him crap for, but it was. We're talking about the 10-year-old Budweiser from the other week. Because Dave just cracked open 1996.
That's okay.
96.
So this thing's legal.
Yeah.
My goodness. A 96. I don't know that
this
we.
This could be vinegar at this point. No one knows.
I don't know that we qualify to drink a beer this old.
So I brought up how we had
it. The beer is old enough to drink itself at this point.
Yeah.
That's true. So I brought up the we had the 10-year-old Budweiser.
What is this?
Rinse for.
Water. What is this? Water.
Please don't drink that one.
There's no.
What is this?
It's like drinking the swill at.
Pure vodka.
Drinking the swill at a homebrew comp.
So I'm thoroughly. Would this be a weird beer, Jeff?
What's the style?
20-year-old.
Oh yeah, there's definitely some, but light for sure.
20-year-old.
What is it?
Due to 1996.
So wait, what was the one? What was the Budweiser we had?
2006 Private Reserve.
It was 2006.
Yep. For employees only. Yeah.
Yeah, we drank a Private Reserve Budweiser.
And they threw out the bottle. Can you believe
that? I think it might be.
Really? That's got to be on a wall somewhere.
It was really weird. It actually tasted like a barley wine. It was really insane.
It was a doppelbock.
Interesting stuff.
Couldn't figure it out.
We found out afterwards
warning. It says on the label, brewed with spices.
Oh, all right. Well, I wonder how the spices lasted 20 years.
Southern tier, right?
I'm glad they're completely gone now. Yeah.
And the sediment's pretty well packed at the bottom of the bottle now, 20 years later.
It smells like a Belgian strong, to be honest with you. It's got that real Belgian strongy
smell. I'm
kind
of impressed how good it smells being 20 years old.
No cardboard for sure.
Man,
if it's on there?
No, I haven't had one yet, no. If the seal held up, this might be incredible.
Oh.
That sediment is definitely packed in there, huh?
It really does. It smells like a Belgian strong, no cardboard, no off
So this
scent.
Is Brasserie de Vapor. Healthy for you got there.
Yeah, go for it, Jeff. God.
No, I didn't. What? Is that more than everybody else got?
Probably not.
We all got a third. You got half.
It's what you need.
Yours is more higher than mine, jerk.
Whatever, dude. Nose is pretty solid.
What's the style?
This is a Saison. It's Brasserie de Annan from Brasserie de Vapor in Pipax, Belgium.
Saison.
1996.
It's 8% alcohol. 20-year-old Saison. Yeah.
This is good.
This is fantastic.
For 20 years old. Yeah. Didn't know what to expect.
The nose is a lot better than the taste.
This could have easily been vinegar at this point. We're like,
oh, yeah.
It has a touch of vinegar. Yeah, not a lot.
It has a touch of sourness. I'm not
probably
sure.
Probably not more than it started with. Yeah. Really. It's probably pretty close.
It's a Saison.
It reminds me of like a black IPA in the sense that sometimes you smell a black IPA and you get one beer, and then you drink a black IPA and you get a completely different beer. This is like you smell it and you get this like amazing quad, and then you drink it and you get this like soury almost. I won't say Saison because it's definitely not hoppy, But you get like a soury Belgian-y
high-bodied Gueuze.
Like a Flemish red almost?
Yeah. I'll give it that.
Yeah, it's got some of that.
Well, it does have
it's
some
a Flemish. Yeah, it's Flemishy. Yeah.
You know, well, the Belgians use a lot of older hops, and older hops will fade with 20 years in the bottle. So
most hops will fade. Yeah, 20 years in the bottle, the hops will go away. But it does. Yeah, it drinks like
really well.
I would say like a little higher bodied Gueuze is what I think it is, because it's a little bit salty, not overly vinegary, and not very tart, but very. I mean, honestly, like if I ordered this at a bar and poured it out of a bottle, I'd think it was good. So I'm.
Yeah,
for 20 years, that's pretty amazing.
Yeah. Hey, Jeff. I agree. Guess what time it is? It's plug it anywhere time.
Plug it anywhere time?
You plug it anywhere time.
All right.
Anything to plug?
What does that mean?
You plug anything you want.
Plug anything you want. Anywhere you want.
This guy has been around a major part of the beer industry in this county for quite a while now. So much so that, you know, the Sierra Nevada Beer Camp series, where they take some people and actually send them to Sierra Nevada to learn how to... This guy was one of the first ones and brewed one of the national releases of the Sierra Nevada Beer Camp.
Which one did you make?
I made Beer Camp 57, Raiders of the Last Hops.
Oh, love it.
I have that one. Sorry.
That was where you actually
Red IPA.
On the hops field.
Yeah, like the hops. So they left some of their hops up for us.
It's an Indiana Jones
play. Down. Yeah, it's perfect. So we literally pulled them out of Sierra Nevada's hop field and grabbed them down. The hops literally stripped them right there and then dumped them right into our beer. So all fresh hopped.
That is awesome.
That's super
them
awesome.
On, some wood, lemon wood. So Red IPA when Red IPAs weren't even around. So
I think Imperial Reds are the lost style of beer.
For sure.
That need to be brought back. I love Imperial Reds.
Is that your plug?
No.
Red IPAs?
No. I mean, I don't know what my plug is. My plug is Coasters Belgian event.
True that.
That's a good pick. That's a very good pick.
That's why we're here.
That's why we're here, right?
Okay. Rare. I mean, we just had Cantillon, so I can't say that it's not going to be amazing.
I've cleared out everything except the beer I started with, which is the Two-Hearted.
Two-Hearted.
and
Mac is plugging Bell's Two-Hearted.
Yeah.
and it still tastes... Well, I tell you, I didn't dump anything except I just emergency because I needed a glass. I dumped about an ounce of his.
It's okay, man.
But
we'll
I tasted
survive.
It before I dumped it, and it was still really good.
So I'll plug two things. I'll plug myself first. Adventures in Beer with brewer Jason Strobel. I started as the Dining Brewer Company, which is my home brewery. I share my beers around Brevard now. You know, I'm a dad. So my aspirations have significantly dropped off in creating a brewery, but I do like to put beers on tap at places like Coasters, which I've had multiple beers on tap here, World of Beer, multiple places on tap there.
Oh, awesome.
Mansion, a lot of other places, a lot of great places here in Brevard. We're a great brewing company community. So my page, and then I also like to bring out Coasters because we have a Brewfest coming up next week, Belgian Brewfest. Some of the best, amazing... Belgian beers are going to be on tap, in bottle. Things that you can't get anywhere else are going to be here. As I said earlier in this podcast, Coasters marches to the beat of their own drum. They do in a good way. They really, truly make the best of what they have. And
This is off the Coasters beer engine. It's not out of the regular 38-degree tap.
Okay. Got a little bit distracted during my shout-out because
anyway,
of the beer.
Well, what's cool about this area, though, is because I know Kevin. I know that everybody, all the other beer brewers around here. We're buddy. We're not competitors. We're collaborators around here.
It's true.
Because we're not fighting over market share.
Right.
That speaks to the craft beer community.
Yeah. It does.
And that's the way it is.
You come here, you get a certain type of beer. You go to the Mansion, you get a certain type of beer. You go to World of Beer, you get a certain type of beer. You go to the Broken Barrel, you get a certain type of beer. You go any of the breweries, Intra, you know, Playa Linda, you get a certain type of beer. And everybody plays well together. Everybody plays in the sand, and everybody's happy with each other. And they each bring something unique, which is great in Brevard.
Mac, any plugs? Anything you gotta mention?
I will second what Jason says. This is a really nice beer county for
it's friendly,
the state of
right?
Florida.
It's friendly.
It's friendly. It's long and narrow. It can be a 50 miles from one bar to another, or it can be 5 miles from one bar to another. But we all play together, and I'm a retired rocket scientist. Okay, so beer is a hobby.
Yeah.
Okay, but I've been at it long enough, that and you will find go in here later tonight and ask anybody if they know Mac Monroe, and somebody will say, yeah, and he said, he talks too much, you know. and it's a valid criticism.
Story of my life.
It's a truly valid criticism.
As a customer here years ago, I met some of the most interesting people here that I've ever met, because it's a lot of business travelers and really people with great histories. And
yeah.
So, David.
Ooh, the pepper comes through. I like it. Yeah, that's cool. Really cool.
It's your turn to plug it anywhere.
Obviously.
I'm going to guess what you're going to plug.
Belgian event.
Of course.
First of all, that's why we're here, yeah.
I'm going to plug Belgian event in general. If you want to take a trip, and you can afford the time to go overseas, now's a great time to travel because the dollar is strong, the euro is cheap. And if you can manage to go over there from Belgium, Germany, and see it on your own, it's amazing. It's well worth it. It really is. It's a totally different environment. You're not going to find the selection that you find over here at a beer bar. But what you find is going to be people really intensely crazy about their local town's beers or their wines or liquors or anything like that. It's an eye-opening experience. You really have to go to Europe.
Experience it all here next week at Coasters.
Yeah,
I was going to say, if you can't travel, at least travel to Melbourne and get some Belgian beers at Coasters.
So I'm going to plug Coasters Pub and Beer Garden. We will be here this Saturday by the time this airs, the 5th. Me and Jeff.
That's me.
And Jeff is over there. We'll be here mingling, hanging out, enjoying Belgian beers, foods. We'll be here with all these guys, hopefully. I know Dave is going
to
be here.
You know I'm buying a bomber that Cantillon.
Yeah?
It's hard not to.
Why not? It's amazing. Yeah.
So be sure to come out March 4th, 5th, and 6th for the Coasters Pub and Beer Garden Belgian Beer Fest. We'll be here the 5th. I don't know what time we're going
to
be here. We'll be here we'll be here all day.
We'll be here for the day.
We'll be here for a few hours, a couple hours.
As I think I said earlier, he doesn't take them off until they blow. So I'm looking forward to 2 weeks of Belgian beers.
Yeah. However,
it's my motto with women.
Sad part from my point of view is after the weekend, the Belgian food's going to go away.
Yeah. Okay. So what we do, though,
we're about to get down on that.
During the openings, Friday morning, the doors open at noon, and Saturday mornings, the doors open at 11. We're going to have 6-liter bottles of St. Bernard Sap 12. They're going to be poured for free. The big samples out of this big old bottle of beer.
Oh, we'll
have a line out the door.
My gosh.
I got one of those bottles. How many did you get?
Yeah.
We'll have a few. Yeah.
We'll have a line out the door.
If you come next weekend, be prepared to stand.
Okay. Yeah.
All right. We're there.
And be responsible, of course.
Please,
don't drink and drive. That's not cool.
Smoke and fly.
Of course.
For God's sakes, there's Uber.
Or Uber. Yeah, you guys have Uber down here?
Uber.
Uber's everywhere.
Uber's everywhere.
Uber down here. Support local. So I am Mike. We got Jeff. Jason. Mac and David here at Coasters Pub and Beer Garden in Melbourne. We'll see you in a couple days.
Yep.
Cheers.
Cheers, everybody.
Cheers, indeed.